Welcome, everyone. Welcome again to your favorite show, this series called Lights, Camera, On Air. I'm so happy to be back again after a week that we took a break last week. Well, it was actually not a break because we were actually working on some big projects. But anyway, we are back again for episode number 9 of this show called Lights, Camera, On Air, a show produced here in Showcase Media Studios in Mexico City. And yeah, today's episode is called Transitioning Events from In-Person to Virtual Events, right? This has been a very trendy topic in the last months, of course, because of the pandemic. A lot of businesses and organizations have been trying to make this transition from physical events in a big room to virtual events, just like maybe this one. So one more time, welcome everyone. If you are watching us from somewhere around the world, please let us know in the comments. I'm so happy to be back again today. Again, Lights, Camera, On Air is a series that we're producing here in Mexico City in our studio. And this series, or this show, has the goal to connect people that are curious and passionate about this world of virtual events and broadcasting and media productions, but that don't know how or where to get started. And we are doing this by sharing some of our secrets and techniques within our creative processes. So we hope that you enjoy it, because today we're going to be talking about a very interesting topic, which is how to make this transition happen. In case you are an event organizer or you want to create your own event as well, then this episode is for you. So I'm so happy to be back, but also I'm so happy to say hi to my team that is helping me make this possible again. I'm not doing this on my own. There is a big team working like a lot, even more than me. But I just want to say hi to, first of all, Jorge. Jorge right there in the back, Jorge and Pablo. They are helping with the audio engineering, the streaming production, all this technical stuff that I am not very aware of what's happening back there. But also, we have working with us remotely, we have Dani and Ana Pau from the north of Mexico in this city called Monterrey. They are also helping us in positioning our show, of course, and showcasing media across social media platforms. And they're also helping us build a community in YouTube. So please, if you have some questions about today's episode, if you want to reach out, make sure that you write your comments, and then Dani and Apau are going to be there with you. Unfortunately, Dani could not be joining us today. She was not feeling very well this morning. So from here, from Mexico City, from the studio, Dani, please get well very soon. And big hello from here. And as for me, I'm Omar. I'm the founder of Showcaser Media. And also, as you can see, I'm the host of this show. So very happy to see you all here. All right? So let's get moving, because I'm actually very excited about today's episode. Oh, by the way, yes, I forgot to mention this. If you haven't subscribed to our channel, we have all the episodes. This is episode number 9. So if you haven't been able to see the previous episodes, make sure to subscribe to the YouTube channel. And then you can see there on screen that we have all the episodes available. Amazing conversations from how to get started as a content creator, going through editing videos like a pro, how to build brand affinity for your company, and storytelling and more other topics that are so good. So definitely I encourage you to go through those videos, to those recordings, because there's a lot of things that you can learn in there. All right, so let's keep moving. Subscribe to the channel and hit the like button, and let's keep going on, all right? So today, I'm very excited because this is gonna be a different episode. I'm telling you this right now. This is gonna be a different episode. We have a different setup right here at the studio. And the reason why is because for the first time in the history of this series, our special guest is right here at the studio, right? So it's not gonna be a virtual conversation. It's actually gonna happen in the studio. And we're going to be having Mariana. She's the national president of AIESEC in Mexico. We're going to be talking about how did we manage to make this transition from these big events, conference events, if you are familiar but it's not, you'll hear more about it. How do we make this transition because of the pandemic to virtual events? So stay tuned because we have an amazing guest, amazing conversation, and yes, I'm so excited for it. So let's get to it, all right? So the first segment, as you all know, and this is a very special segment for me because we are creating a documentary that is telling the story of Showcase Media as a company. How did we end up here? And this documentary is called Retrospective. And today we are presenting chapter number 9, which is called Reinvention. And today, for this chapter, we're going to be talking about what you see right here, which is Showcase Media Studios. And yes, like how we wanted to make this place, like building it up, and also how is this place actually transforming the core of our business, right? So I'm very excited to present it to you, chapter number 9 out of 10. Next episode, we're gonna have the finale of this documentary. So I'm very excited to present it to you. So Jorge, if you are ready, let's play it, and hope you like it. Take care. Today, I'll tell you about Showcaser Media Studios. Creativity knows no limits, and one of the things I truly admired from creators all across the globe during this pandemic was the way they managed to transform their homes into creative dojos in order to stay creative. For us at Showcaser Media, this would not be an exception. We knew that if we wanted this company to keep thriving, we had to make a quite significant investment to build a production studio that could suit our needs. And so, the dream began. In a matter of 2 months, we transformed an empty space at home in a place that could allow us to bring our creative ideas to life. From cinema cameras and live production switchers, to TV studio sets with pro lights and audio gear, little by little, Showcase Media Studios was getting equipped to start operating. Producing videos in a brand new studio made us realize that opportunities for us were now unlimited. We felt ready to give the next step, producing virtual events live from the studio. And it didn't take too long for us to close our first large-scale virtual event. It's hard to put into words the impact that this studio has represented for Showcaser Media. This place has allowed us to rethink and evolve our business core from beginning to end. But most importantly, it has taught us that reinvention is a crucial part of success. In business, as in life, you have to reinvent to stay fresh, to stay in the game. Our first virtual event turned out to be a huge success. The moment felt right to put our creativity to the test as we embrace the world of episodic live shows. Hello again. So yes, that was Retrospective chapter number 9 called Reinvention with the story of Showcase Media Studios. Yes, so this that you can see is Showcase Media Studios. So yeah, I hope you liked it. Remember, the next episode we're going to have the finale of the documentary. So stay tuned for that. So now let's move on to the next segment, which is the Let's Get Hacky section. This is a space where we are providing you some of our hacks, some of our knowledge. And right now, or today, we're going to be talking about specifically hybrid events. So maybe you have heard about this term, hybrid events. So if you are not familiar with it, it's actually been very trendy in the last months because it's a way for you to mix in-person events with virtual events, right? So you're trying to deliver an experience to your attendees via virtually and also presentially in case this is an option for some of you. Right now, there is no option for like a lot of countries, but there is right now some countries that are actually embracing this mix between in-person events and virtual events. So that's the term, hybrid events. So today we're gonna be giving you the 5 hacks for a successful hybrid event, right? So the first hack that we have for you is you need to invest in production of your event. So if you want people to invest their time at your event, I think you might as well invest in high quality production, right? You wanna offer them the best experience, the best content, the best quality. And I think this is like very mandatory if you wanna have a successful hybrid event. So some of the recommendations we have for you is first, have a virtual hub where people that are not able to attend physically or even virtually because of their time and their schedule, I think it's very important for them to have a space where they can access all these sessions, all this information at the time that they have actually available in their schedule, right? Something that we also recommend is that you can maybe invest in a virtual venue so that you can gather all your attendees and people are in one spot. They can be able to connect with each other, to talk to each other, and this is going to be very useful for them to build a community. And the next thing that we've been seeing that has been very successful is having an important engagement planned in between your sessions. So when you have those breaks happening between sessions, if you are able to create some activity so that people can connect, can interact, or can engage through maybe social media, this can actually be very useful for you and the purpose of your event. The second point, and we've learned this from some events we've actually attended before, hire a virtual host moderator or moderator. So it's very important that you can have someone that is able to set the right mood for your attendees throughout your event. So maybe your event is 3 or 4 or 6 hours long, so you want to have someone that is able to come back once in a while to build a connection, to make some activities, to have like very good engagement. And this is going to be very useful for your attendees to be like really focused, really motivated for B2E in your event. Cool? The next point is, I think this is a very common mistake, because you have to think strategically about the timing for your event. Your virtual event does not need to, and probably should not, have the same duration and cadence of its in-person equivalent. This is something we have seen in some events where they are trying to incorporate the same logistics or like the same time, the same agenda for like an in-person to a virtual event. And this is something that you should reconsider because yes, in an in-person event, you have the restriction of having everyone in a physical event. But when it comes to a virtual event, you don't have everyone at your disposal in a physical event, in a physical venue. So then, try to think of how much time can you actually ask for your attendees to be present at your event, and try to make it very specific and very simple so that they can actually enjoy the time that they are spending for your virtual event. Remember, we are right now like we are jumping from virtual events to virtual events. Like there's virtual events everywhere. So you really want to make sure that if people are going to invest that small amount of time, it's going to be the best for your outcome. The fourth point is also very crucial, which is test, and test, right? So when it comes to connectivity issues that you can maybe have in your event, so make sure that your internet connection is very stable, that you can do everything as possible to make it consistent. Also very important that if you have some speakers, some like maybe conferences or some panels in your event, that you can have the space for these people to have rehearsals so that when the time comes, things are gonna run as smooth as possible. And the last point is very important as well, which is the contingency plan. So what happens if something wrong happens, or if something like if there's a problem with the connection, or if maybe a speaker doesn't show up to your event, which could happen. So maybe it's very important that you can have that contingency plan, just map out when things can work perfectly, how does it look like, but when what happens when things are not working as you planned. So have that also in mind. And the last point is also something we've seen that people have taken advantage of, is create special opportunities for maybe sponsors, right? So right now, maybe when you're not having that potential income from your maybe physical events, maybe you can have, if you can guarantee that there is a specific amount of people showing up to your event, then this can actually be very good for maybe some sponsorships opportunities. So try to approach those businesses, maybe those startups that would like to have this presence in your event, and maybe those eyeballs going to that brand. Find spots for ads or commercials within your event, and maybe try to sell some of those spaces in your agenda for maybe some panels, some keynotes, and maybe some specific conferences. But I know that there is like so many companies out there that would be willing to spend some money to show up in your event. And the last point, social media engagement, that you can also offer to your maybe your partners or maybe some companies, that you can just position their brand in their social media. So that can also be very beneficial for like maybe both sides. So that's the last hack for you. And now we're gonna go to the next segment, which is gonna be our music break with, you know who, Drumpet, Julia and Alex are gonna be rocking the show for us. So I'll see you in the next segment. So, welcome again. Those were Drumpet, the music duo with Alex and Julia. I really hope that you enjoyed it. We really enjoy having Drumpet in the house. So yes, I'm back again here in a different scenario, in a different, I don't know, setup. And because I told you in the beginning that we are going to have a different show today, we're going to be having a special guest at the studio that you can see on screen. She's Mariana Gaxiola. She's the national president of AIESEC in Mexico. And I'm very excited to have her joining today here the show at the studio. So welcome, Mariana. How are you today?
Hello, Mark.
Welcome
Thank
again
you.
To the studio.
Yeah, I'm really used to be here now, right? I'm spending a lot of time here in the last months. So yes. I'm just really happy to be here. Like, thank you so much for the invitation. Like, when you told me, I was like, yes, why not? Like, coming and helping you with this and talk about something that became normal to us,
yes.
no? Like, coming here and recording our conferences. So
yes.
thank you so much for the invitation. I'm really happy to be here.
I'm also very happy, very excited because, again, this is the first time we're having someone in the studio. Before, it was just virtual conversations with our guests. But now, as you maybe have seen, like it's a different logistics that we are doing here. A lot of movement behind the cameras that you are not able to see, but believe me, it's a lot of movement right here. But just to give you some context, Mariana and me met back in, what was it? Was it
2018, yes.
Yes, December, right?
December 2018.
Yeah. So
2 years ago,
there's this picture because we actually ran by accident. It was
yes.
we ran into each other in an airport because we were both heading to a conference, another event for AIESEC in Canada, in Montreal, right? So we
yes.
met by accident in the airport. It was like, hey, hello.
So yes, it was really random because I was going to Canada to
yes.
be facilitator of this conference. They were inviting me, and then they were like, there is a guy from our team that is also coming, like he's from Mexico and he's also coming to Canada. So I was like, you have the same flight. I was like,
yes.
that's great.
Yes.
So maybe we can help each other in
yeah.
the airport.
So that was very curious that we just met there. I mean, we have been part of AIESEC before in Mexico, but
yes.
I don't think it was right
no,
there.
No, we never met before in Mexico. It was until there.
So this is a picture of the event we went to in 2018, December. So it was just like the new year.
Yes.
And I was telling you this earlier, but I want to share it with the people right here in the audience. I spent a lot of time trying to find her in this picture, trying to find Mariana in this picture.
I got lost.
This was the conference picture at the end of the event. And I was like, hey, where is Mariana? Like, I don't see her. And then I remembered that you had to leave early because
yes.
then you had to come back to Mexico.
I had another conference here, so I was not
yes.
staying until the end.
Yeah, so
I was not in that picture, definitely.
but don't worry, because I actually found the picture of you here
dancing.
In my archive of photos. This is Mariana just having the most fun dancing, or I don't know what you were doing here, but yeah, I found
I
her.
I think I was dancing.
So there is proof that she was in the event, so don't
yes.
worry. So yeah, I just wanna show the audience, because maybe we have some people that were part of AIESEC, maybe there's no like
yes.
familiar people of AIESEC. I just wanna show this video. It doesn't have any audio on it because of copyright, but just to give some context to the audience, like how does an AIESEC conference look like? So you can see here a lot of people having fun, people from the country, or maybe international people joining this event. You can see a lot of dancing. You can see a lot of the culture of these young people having a lot of fun, sharing some knowledge of the organization. So yeah, this is how an AIESEC conference looked like, no? People from all over the country having fun. And yeah, like, I don't know about you, Mariana, but when I see this, like, oh my God, like, I really miss the
yes.
feeling of being in a physical event, no? I don't know about you. So To start the conversation, I would like maybe just for you to give some context to the audience of what is it that you're doing right now in AIESEC in Mexico, what's your role, and the question is specifically why are in-person events so relevant for organizations like AIESEC?
Yes. So I will start just to talk about like the context of AIESEC, because many people doesn't really know what we do as an organization. So we are an international organization and we are focused to work with youth, to work with young people, and we are all volunteers. Normally our range of age goes from 18 to 30 years. Like normally in AIESEC in Mexico, we have people from 18 to 25. I'm 25, so I'm one of the oldest, but we have like really, really young people working with us, volunteering for AIESEC. And what we strive for in AIESEC is to achieve peace and fulfillment of humankind's potential, but mostly we want to develop leadership. And we really believe like we will develop leadership through exchanges. So we do multicultural exchanges from volunteerings and also professional internships abroad. So I discovered AIESEC 6 years ago and I fell in love in the organization. So I had like many different positions like abroad. I was in AIESEC in Turkey, and now like I was working here in Mexico too, and now I came back as national president. And like talking specifically about the conference, like as you guys saw in the video, it was like really, really huge. And you can see like we met going to a conference because we were participating and conference was part of our life, our part still of our life in AIESEC. And it's a huge thing and it's really part of the organizational culture. And we have like international conference, national conferences, local conference, because in AIESEC we are present in more than 120 countries. And we have even this huge international conference in the middle of the year. And we have like more than like thousands of persons like joining together from all over the world, and it's crazy. And as part of AIESEC in Mexico, we also have like 4 national conferences each year. And it's like part of us. Like we join, we gather together more than, our biggest conference are like more than 600, 700 people. And it's part of us in order to first like provide education to our membership and also to be aligned, having one direction as an entity and as organization, but also to share and have this connection between people. Because for me, AIESEC is also a lot about the people that you met and the people that you discovered there in the organization and how we learn from each other. Yeah. So I think this is the special moment, like the conference, when you really go there and disconnect from the world and just spend like 7 days in a hotel. So yes, it was like really, really part of us. And now we're trying to change this because we cannot lose this spirit just because of a pandemic, but we're trying to innovate and turn everything into virtual. So this has been our challenge this year.
Yeah, here we can see a photo of your team.
Yes.
Very happy team. Maybe you can recognize the background because it's actually a photo that we took here at the studio. But yeah, you were mentioning, I mean, we were looking at the video of how a conference looks like when things are normal, let's say. But you mentioned something about the pandemic, no? And I wanna ask you, so let's talk about COVID-19 and how this global pandemic was able to shut down every in-person event, every conference around the world. What was the immediate impact for AIESEC as an organization that relies a lot on events, both like impacts in like positively and negatively? What can you tell me about that?
Yes, as I told you, like to put you in context how everything of this pandemic started for me, like I was working in Turkey. Actually, you were there in that moment too when the pandemic started. And we were in a conference, no? Like we were having this regional conference. As I told you, we make really, really huge conferences in AIESEC, and we were having more than 500 persons from all over Europe. And we didn't expect that this was going to happen. So we decided to continue with the conference, but We even had to cut it in the middle. We couldn't finish because borders started to close and everything was really going really, really fast. And I think there was a lot of confusion, no, between the people that were leading the organization. We didn't know how this pandemic was going to head, what we needed to do. And we are an organization that do exchanges, no? So this was our main direct impact. We had to stop our operations. We had a really big summer. People were going to travel to do their volunteer all around the world. But we took the decision first to stop our operations for a while until we knew like what was going to happen and how can we change as organization. So like first, our main core business stop, that was operations and exchanges. So this was like kind of hard for us, but we were finding the way to adapt. Right now in terms of exchanges, we are back on, but having like more strict measures, like really understanding how we can travel and continue our life with all of this. And we are even innovating, doing remote exchanges, doing semi-remote exchanges in which you can start like virtually and then continue physically your exchange. So it has been like a whole journey. And also in terms of having these conferences, as I told you, is part of us, is part of our organization. Like we said, like we cannot stop having these kind of events. We still need to provide this education, these trainings to our members. And also we still need to have this connection between us, and we still need to talk about the direction that we will provide to the organization and join together, even in a virtual way. So the implication was this, like also we have to shift into having virtual events and virtual conferences. And we expect the first challenge for us was there in March. And we had a conference coming in April in AIESEC in Mexico, and it was totally canceled because of governmental restrictions and everything that was happening. But it was when we started to think about having this virtual conference. And I think like not everything was negative, because something positive was now like in a physical way. So not all the people have the opportunity to come and experience this because of economic or availability or any other reasons. But now like having this virtual way, like we were able to really have like all the presence of all our members, no? Or at least they had the opportunity to be online and be connected and receiving this information. So we were like really more available to all the people in the country, and also like international people that wanted to see our events. So yes, I think it has like even positive and negative aspects as everything, but we were trying to evolve.
I remember in last episode, I was mentioning that in every difficulty lies an opportunity, no? And I remember being back there in Turkey as well. A lot of uncertainty in like everywhere, like in the streets, in like everywhere you go, you went, there was like a lot of uncertainty. But I think that's the moment when we started thinking, okay, what can we do out of this situation, no? So yeah, for us as well was the same thing. How as a company could we transform and take this problem as an opportunity, no? So yeah, I remember a lot of what you're saying, this event in Turkey. But then you were also mentioning how you were trying to make this new approach to virtual events. So I would like you to tell me about this first approach that you had for your first virtual event. Was it called Light Up Event Conference? So what were the mistakes that you found throughout that transition? And on the other hand, the areas of opportunity that you discovered in this event. And actually, I think I have a video here. This is your first attempt of your virtual event over Zoom. I can tell that there was a lot of confusion in the beginning because no one knew if you were live or it was just interesting to see. But again, this is the first approach trying to adapt to the new times. So what can you tell me of the big learnings and mistakes?
It was a good trial, I think, to be the first time. To be really honest, as you said, like, it was everything so uncertain. Like, we didn't know what to do. We were canceling this conference and we were like, should we do another conference or not? Like, we didn't know how many weeks, days this pandemic will take. And we were having hope even to have the event. We were really positive in that moment. We still are, but we were having hope actually to have the conference. But the weeks passed and then we said like, we think this will not be able to happen. Yes, it's not gonna work. So someone had an idea. Let's make the conference virtual, no? Let's Skylet light up conference. But it was really, really fast because we took the decision and we just had 2 weeks to produce all the conference. And of course you need to create an agenda, you need to create the whole event, you need to think about the technical part, about the production. And as you can see in the video, like, we are not really experts. We were not really experts. Like, we as AIESEC have the knowledge to do a physical conference and, and we have like the really good knowledge about this, about how to create sessions and talk and engage with the audience. But we are not experts in production, as you are. But we were trying to use the tools that we have and, and that also were free for us, that are Zoom and YouTube Live and this kind of stuff. And but we had a lot of difficulties. Is like, first, we didn't know like when the when we were starting, we didn't know if we were live or not. We were like managing how to really engage with our audience, how to deliver these sessions. But I think the main problem was the production that we were having, not the internet connection, the platforms. So we realized we were not experts in this. And of course, like, we needed to evolve, of course. But we realized we're going to keep having a virtual conference, that like this situation is not changing anyway soon. So when we had to do like our next conference that was in August, we said like, we really need to invest into this, like more money, time, production, and get to know more about like this technical part, no? That was missing the most in the last conference.
Yeah, that's true. Also in the last episode, and I think this is a moment where our paths crossed, because we were, as you saw in the video on our documentary, we just were building this studio, and then we were like, okay, we need to put this studio to work. We want to explore possibilities, and that's where our paths crossed. No? So you were looking for more experience and more production, and we were looking for the opportunity to put our studio to the test. But again, on last episode, Torben was one of our main guests and special guests. He was mentioning something in the lines of, you want to have a virtual event, no? So then you need to identify what are your strengths and your weaknesses, no? What are your strengths and weaknesses? And when it comes to your weaknesses, you need to ask for help, no?
Of course.
You need to ask for help. And then, that was the moment where our paths crossed. We knew we could help you with these conferences. We knew we could provide the infrastructure, the production, the logistics, so that you could focus on what you do best, which is deliver content, which is providing the experience to your delegates. So in our first, let's say, event we hosted in August, as you were mentioning, what can you describe now? How was this journey different from the first one, the first event, Light Up, to Everest 2020? What did you learn? What was the experience that your team had? And what can you tell me about it?
Yes.
I want to be showing a video in the background of how things looked like that day.
I love that conference. It's really, really cool memories. It was really special for us because we were starting as a team and it was our first moment together, but also it marked like the beginning of this like new generation. And in AIESEC, like, we change every year the persons that are leading the organization. So it was our first event, let's say. And to be honest, we were not really thinking about, like, we knew that we needed to change, but it was a coincidence that you brought me in that moment. We were talking about, like, do you need help in Turkey? Are you okay? Because you were still there and I was already in Mexico. And then you were like, hey, I'm creating this project. I know you do conference. Are you having an event soon? And I was like, yes, let's talk. I think it will be a good idea to work together. And we came from doing a conference in a laptop and a Zoom and joining the persons in a call into having this amazing conference in a studio, no? So we were really not used to this. First, we don't know how to talk to a camera. Like, it was really hard. We were like, we wanted to see us in the TV, and you were like, no, look at the camera.
And yes,
like, don't pretend, just like act natural. And we were like robots, no? Like, hello. Because we are used to having, like, yes, we used
the
to, yes, the interaction with the people, like to see them and screen and feel the energy, but having, like, doing everything virtually is so different, no? Like, you can see the comments on YouTube and people talking and you can interact in a different way. But first we needed to get used to that. Like, we needed to get used to really talk to a camera, to do everything in a virtual way. And I think the second thing is, like, you cannot, for example, this kind of conference for us is 7 days.
Yes.
But it's a really huge conference with 700 people locking them down 7 days in a hotel. But we understood that this cannot happen because our members were already tired in August. Like, we were having 4 months of being in lockdown in this pandemic, and there are people that are students or there that work, but they were having all their life became virtual.
Yeah.
AIESEC became virtual for them.
School.
Their school, their work, having doing home office, even talking with their friends or something like in a video call, everything became virtual. So we cannot have them for 8 hours per day or 10 hours of agenda that we had before, like for 7 days in a row. So we needed to also adapt. So we turned our conference just in 2 days, on the weekend. And we try to reduce our agenda the less time possible, like do 6 hours of agenda and really adapt into this. And I think it was also a challenge to innovate how to deliver the sessions, because you cannot do the same physical, you cannot do the same activities. So we needed to really make them feel that we were having a real and normal, let's say, AIESEC conference, and for them to feel the same connection. I think at the end, people were amazed about the production that we had, and everything turned out like really, really great. But I think it's a journey, no, of learning. We already done like 2 conferences, and we are going for the 3rd one in 1 month. I'm really excited for what can come. But I think it's always like going out of the box and innovate, and also think a lot about the people that you're interacting with. Like, think, for example, for us, think about the members, think about how are they feeling, think about the journey that they are experiencing, because I think for many people, like, this change, like, in our lives has been huge. So it's about, like, how we can adapt to them and give them a real experience. And for them to want to invest their time in our event, no? Because it's like time is so valuable, and I think right now people is taking care about the time that they spend on a screen even more, and taking like more wiser decision about what they see and how do they wanna spend their time.
Time.
So we just wanna make it worth it for them.
Yeah, I mean, you were mentioning that. I mean, you were feeling very nervous in front of the camera.
Yes.
And that's very experience. I think for us it was also the same kind of vibe, no? We were also testing the studio. We were like doing everything we could for the very first time. And yeah, you were saying it's about learning by doing, no?
And of course.
I think we both had that very great experience, and the event turned out to be successful. You can see here the picture of the team in that first attempt. And yeah, you were also saying we had another conference. So it's been already two events, and I want to be showing the video of the next of the event we had just a month ago. So after two events at the studio, with like a lot of innovation, a lot of trying new things, what were the main, like your main learnings after these couple of events that we just had here at the studio? What can you tell me about it? This is the video, the second video.
Yes, I can say, like, first, we need to know, like, everything that comes after and behind a virtual conference, because sometimes we think, it's really easy, no? Because it's virtual, you just record, give your session, but that's not all. Like, there's a lot of things and logistics behind the event, and I want to explain a little bit how our team is conformed in terms of the conference. So we have all the team of facilitators, that is my team, my national team in AIESEC, that we are the ones creating the content and providing the sessions. We have the agenda managers that are some persons in the team that are in charge of creating this agenda, think about the message that we want to give in the conference and creating all the sessions, all the flow, all the timing. Mm-hmm. And we have this conference team that are the ones making all the logistics and the production, and we have you as showcaser media, no? And yes, I think it's not only about just coming and recording a session, but we have a lot of months of preparations. So I think it's a lot about the synergy that you have between these teams, and I think it's very important to approach the experts, no? Like, we learn that we are not experts in production, but that you are, so that you can help us about this, and that it take us a lot of worries and save us a lot of time, and we trust you completely. I think the hardest thing for a virtual conference is the production. Like, is the production, all the technical part, all the internet, all the streaming, all the platform that you're using. And as I told you, we are not experts on this. So for us, it was really calm just to focus on prepare the best content that we can give and to think about the different ways that we can do the sessions, because we trust 100% that you as a showcaser media will take care of the production. But I think if my team were worried about like, what can I do? How, I don't know, the internet is not working, or YouTube is not working, or this platform, it will be like really, really different. So I think the main learning was to have this whole team and for each of them to have a clear role and for us to have the synergy and really a very, very, very well done plan before the conference about the timing and how we were going to deliver everything together. I think the second thing is, as I mentioned before, like, take care about your audience and understand what do they want to see, what kind of content, take care a lot about the agenda that you're giving in the event. Like, we've been trying to make the sessions even shorter every time, like just do it maximum 45 minutes, like the longest session, because we know that people get bored, like, just seeing a screen. We also try to put a lot of breaks and make dynamics in the break. Also use the different platforms that we have, like use social media, Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, everything that we can to make them interact. And I think it's a lot about innovation. Like, I think I'm breaking my head to know what to do in the next conference, because it's like, this activity, no, we already did it. We need to do something different. I know this kind of session, no, I think they will get bored. Let's do something else. But it's like really innovating and thinking out of the box to see what people would like and to keep them engaged. And as I told you before, to really invest their time into you and for them to have a quality content. And the other is like also to take care a lot about the delegate experience, no? For them to feel like they are in a virtual conference. We have our conference team and they made t-shirts and I don't know, cups, and they even send them to their houses. Wow. So people were like having the conference t-shirt and the mug and the hat and everything, like with all the AIESEC branding and the conference branding. So we really, I hope we could send more things to them in order to for them to have an experience in the conference. Of course, we need to take care about our budget, but but yes, I think it's about like making them feel this energy and this connection. And even we are virtual, that because they go to conference to meet people and to feel what is AIESEC, no? So we really want to make them interact and make them feel part of the organization, even in a virtual way. So I think it has been a challenge, but we've been having a lot of learnings, and I hope every conference can be even better.
Yeah. I mean, I completely agree with what you're saying. You are asking for people to spend their time,
of course,
with you, no? Yes. So I think you have the responsibility as an event organizer, as someone that is asking for that time, to put the work, put the investment, put like all the efforts to try to have that time to be very well spent, no? And the fact that you are doing these different activities of like sending these materials to their houses, yes, and having several engagement throughout the event, those are efforts that people will really, that will be a differentiator between a very good event from a bad event, no? And I can speak for, I think, for everyone, which we have been attended to like so many events, and if I don't see something different after 1 hour, then I'm lost, no? And also, like, it happens to for us here at the studio with this show event, we are trying to build a show, an event that has different components, different segments. It's not all the same. Like, we have a music break, we have the education segment, we have the speaker, the special guest segment. So we're trying to give some like things different so that people can actually be entertained. And I think that's what people want. Like, people show up because they wanna be entertained. So if you're able to do that with your agenda, with providing the spaces, people will appreciate it for sure. So thank you for that. The next question that I have for you is kind of like to sum up this conversation. And also, if I want to invite the audience, if there is some questions that you want to ask to Mariana, this is the best chance for you. I will be seeing my phone because maybe we have some comments, some questions coming from the audience. Let me know. But kind of like to close, there's clearly an increasing need of virtual events around the world from businesses, organizations. So if you could tell me what are your like overall recommendations, like if you could sum it up for people that are curious about this transition from in-person events to virtual events. So what can you tell me about it, those main points?
Okay, perfect. So yes, I can sum up in a couple of points. I think the first one is don't be afraid to create and try new things. I think for us, it was something completely new. Like, we never thought about having to turn our conference like to completely virtual. And now you were talking even about like hybrid events. And we were now even thinking about doing that, like us streaming, but people in their homes, like gathering together, like in their local committees for us as AIESEC. So I don't know, I think it's a part of keep learning and keep changing things and see the things that are working, the things that are making your audience like more engaged and making you like the event even more. So yes, I think it's a matter of keep trying all the time, because this is something new for everyone, but at the end you are becoming an expert, no? Giving better sessions, of giving a better content, or making it more dynamic and for people to enjoy it more. And I think the second one is surround yourself with people that can support you. As you guys are like, I think we always say like, you save us like all the time for our virtual conference. If you're not expert in production, if you're not expert on creating a event or creating an agenda of creating content for sessions or designing or social media or anything, like gather with the people that can support you and that can help you and give you like an advice. And I think it's very important to know your strengths, but also know your weaknesses and know the things that you can really be supported with in an experience like this. For us, it was more the production part, but for, I don't know, some other persons or some other kind of events can be different things, no? So yeah, to recognize those points. The third one is to understand your audience. For example, I know that the people that is gonna attend my event, as I told you, there are young people between 18 and 25 years old. They study, they work, they do home office, and they just wanna like be entertained. They wanna also have fun, but they wanna have a quality content and they want to learn new things and they want to develop themselves and gain skills. So it's like really understand what do they wanna and what do they wanna take from your event, no? So this is very, very important. And I think that also is like provide quality material. Yeah. I think right now, as you were mentioning, like all the digitalization part like is a huge, huge trend, but also we have a lot of information like in our hands and we can have like a lot of courses that has a lot of content and we can have a really, really quality material, videos, I don't know, online courses, online universities, everything on the web. So I think you need to provide something really good in order for people to really take the decision to see you and invest time in you. So invest like time in the production, but also in the content that you are creating. And the last one is to try to give a real experience to the audience. I think right now that we are, sometimes we are tired, no? Or being like connected all the time or that everything is virtual, but try to give it something different and something that can make them feel that they are in a real event and they are connecting with people. So I think this will be like my main recommendations.
Very good recommendations. So if you are looking at this screen, take a screenshot, take some notes. I want to know, I don't think there's questions. Jorge, can you tell me if there's questions? I don't want to open the YouTube link, but there's no questions, but oh my God, like this has been very, very good, like very good recommendations, very good conversation, Mariana. So I don't know, I really don't have more, but to appreciate your time, your disposition to come to the studio again, to share all this knowledge, to kind of relive again those moments here at the studio. It's been very fun. So if you wanna follow Mariana, that's the LinkedIn. You can find her on LinkedIn. You can find her on Instagram as well. But again, Mariana, it has been a pleasure to have you here today with us in the studio. You're the first guest in the studio. Welcome.
Yay,
and
so
yeah,
great.
I mean, I'll see you very soon, I think, very soon here at the studio.
Of course.
I think in January, we're going to have another event happening here at the studio. So very, very excited for it. So yeah, just to finish this this space, I just want to provide you with the five takeaways of this episode. First, this is coming from the documentary. In business, as in life, you have to reinvent to stay fresh and to stay in the game, right? So don't be afraid to keep reinventing yourself. I think this is part of the process of like achieving success. So don't make the pandemic or like this situation we're living in like something that's gonna stop you, but an opportunity to reinvent the thing that you are doing, right? We also be talking about hybrid events. So this is a definition. A hybrid event is a trade show conference, seminar, workshop, or other meeting that combines a live in-person event with a virtual online component. So it hasn't been, there hasn't been a better time right now to embrace this new era of virtual events. So really go for it. If you need some help, we are here to support you. But again, it's a new opportunity for you to keep engaging with your audience virtually or like in person. The third point, think strategically about the timing for your event. Again, I cannot make a lot of emphasis for this. We have been learning actually with the events in AIESEC in Mexico we've been hosting here. Rethink that your agenda should not be as long as how it is when you are restricted to that physical area. So make the information more specific, make your sessions more like short, provide more spaces, like more break spaces so that people can have some time to maybe go out and like maybe some fresh air, but like don't have them all the time sitting in front of a computer because that's not optimal. The fourth point is to succeed online, you need to seduce your audience, all right? After all, they can leave with a single click of a mouse button, all right? So we've been talking about this with Mariana. Make sure that you are having those that like engaging content that people can find entertaining so that they can actually stay there as much time as they want, because if they don't like what they see, they can just leave with a click, all right? And the last point is something that Mariana has been mentioning again, preparation and alignment is key. So definitely preparing the content, but also alignment with every single, let's say, piece of the puzzle is very crucial so that the event can be as successful as possible. All right, so those are the five takeaways we have for today's episode. I wanna really thank you for showing up to the event today. I'm very excited to have you joining. I also wanna appreciate my team, Jorge backstage and Dani and Pau, that are gonna be having a very interesting week with their thesis, so really good luck from Mexico City to Monterrey, good luck. But also I want to appreciate Mariana for being here with us today. Again, I'm so happy. This actually worked out very well, I think. And we also really hope that you enjoy the format. So Mariana, thank you very much for being here with us today.
Thank you. It was really, really a pleasure. And of course, I'm always happy to continue with this event. So we're going to see each other a lot. We have a lot to do. But thank you so much for the invitation and really happy
You're
to
welcome.
Be here.
So for next episode, episode number 10, the last episode, we're also going to postpone it for next week. We're also going to have a two-week preparation for it. So we'll see you, if I'm not mistaken, on the 18th of December for the season finale, episode number 10. I'm very happy and very excited for that episode. Some more details will come very soon, so don't worry. We'll let you know more of the special guest, more of the topic in social media, so make sure to follow Showcaser Media, at Showcaser Media on Instagram. Subscribe to the YouTube channel if you haven't done so. And yeah, looking forward to see you in 2 weeks' time. And to close this episode, we just have the closing segment with, again, Drumpet rocking the show for us. So enjoy it, and I'll see you in 2 weeks for episode number 10 of Lights, Camera, and Air. Take care. Goodbye. I don't know which camera should I see, but take care. See you soon. It's my life.